Welcome back, Playmakers. I'm Riley Kramer, and we have a lot to cover this week, from J.J. Watt moving on from the Texans to Jayhawk Nation getting a new recruit. All this and more after the intro.
March is just a regular month to your average American, but to college basketball fans, it's even more exciting than Christmas. That's right, Jayhawks, it's March Madness. Get ready to sweat, cry, scream, and cheer, hopefully, all month long as our boys go into the playoffs stronger than expected. KU had a crushing win on number 3 seed Baylor last Saturday, beating them 71-58. The Jayhawks were cutting it close in the first half, where they were only up by 3, but then ran away with the game in the second half. KU's Jalen Wilson's 14 rebounds made it harder for the Bears to make a comeback, along with David McCormick's great performance as he ended the night with 20 points, paired with a monstrous block. Last night, KU had a shockingly close game against unranked UTEP, where the Jayhawks won 67-62. They were down by 14 the first half, but had a striking return in the second half, scoring over double points. Listen to what Coach Self had to say about his boys' win last night.
To execute and get key stops. And so I think that right there should give us some confidence. You know, it's not going to be a huge factor in what happens post this, but it is a factor for seed lines. It's a factor for keeping momentum going and things like that. But when we get to Kansas City, hey, we're going to end up playing a top 20 team in the first round. And to win the tournament, you're going to have to play 3 of them. So yeah, this was good to kind of keep momentum going, but
now it's time to check in on those OU fans, as they have now lost 2 games to their biggest rival, Oklahoma State. They were neck and neck, but both games, the Cowboys came out winning by 4. The first matchup went into overtime as freshman star Cade Cunningham scored over 40 points, leading the Cowboys to defeat the Sooners 94-90. Many OU fans were hopeful going into Monday's matchup. Leaders Austin Reeves and Brady Mankey had 19 and 20 to cap off the night, but it wasn't enough to send home the Cowboys, as they swept the Sooners 79-75. While it is March, we have roughly about a week until Section Sunday, and the Big 12 is stacked with talented teams and players. Wednesday kicked off the Big 12 tournament to see who will be the reigning champs of the Big 12 this year. Stay tuned, as we have a great show ahead in the studio. We have Caleb and Gabe with a total breakdown of now Cardinals J.J. Watt's contract, Jalen with Tweets of the Week, and later our recruit specials welcomes 2 special guests. But before we get into that, Liam has a 90-second update on swim and dive. Liam?
Hello, and welcome to Laps with Liam. Last week saw the Big 12 Championship for swim and diving, in which KU swimmers pulled out several impressive victories and finished with 8 racers finishing with a top 5 time or better. Overall, KU Swim and Dive Club finished second overall with 654 total points. This trailed only UT Austin, who managed an impressive 854. Several racers finished with impressive times, including a new school record for Kate Stewart in the 200-yard individual medley. The record was originally held by swimming legend Chelsea Miller with a mark of 1 minute and 58.17 seconds. However, Kate broke that record set in the 2015 season with her own time of 1 minute and 58 seconds flat. Head coach Clark Campbell remarked, "She is getting it done at every level, in and out of the pool. Chelsea Miller was one of our best swimmers in Jayhawk history, and for her to set a record held by Chelsea is a big deal." In addition to Stewart's medley, the Jayhawks managed to get second place in the 400-meter medley relay, in which Manon Manning, Stewart, Autumn Looney, and Dewey Blows all managed a time of 2 minutes 37.94 seconds. However, the event was highlighted by Manon Manning's sole first-place finish for the Jayhawks. Manning, a senior, was crowned champion of the 200-meter backstroke event with a time of 1 minute 55 seconds. With this victory, she earned a right to compete in the national championship in Greensboro, North Carolina, from March 17th to March 20th. She's the only Jayhawk to qualify for nationals this year. We want to wish the best of luck to Manning and our congratulations to the rest of the competitors at this year's event. Speaking of competition, as Claire mentioned, the Big 12 tournament is this week, and many fans are looking forward to Baylor-KU matchup. Not on the court, but on Twitter. Jalen Colvin has more after this short break.
For students searching for a way to stay active in an outdoorsy way, the city of Lawrence has bike trails running in every direction, and with the new Bike Share program, we can stay in shape as we tour the sights of our beautiful city. Clinton Lake is only a short 30-minute bike ride away from Daisy Hill and has the most incredible sunset location in all of Lawrence. Walking campus may give you the KU calves, but biking can give you the KU thighs. Bike Lawrence today.
Welcome to Tweets of the Week. This week, we will be looking at some of the funny tweets you may have missed or seen while scrolling through Twitter. We've mixed in a few athletes' tweets along with a few fans with passionate opinions. But this week, we are focusing on Barstool tweets. This past weekend, the Jayhawks pulled the upset against the Baylor Bears, an unspoken rivalry, not only in basketball, but Barstool counts as well. Barstool Sikkim, a Baylor Twitter page, went straight to Twitter defending the Bears, saying, "Kansas out here like they won the national championship. Y'all know you still got 8 losses yet." Not long after Jayhawk fans got a hold of the tweet, Barstool KU retweeted a comeback of their own. Would have been 9, but y'all choked. This rivalry dates back to last year, but Barstool Sikkim gained confidence after Baylor took the crown during their last meet. "Thanks for coming out, Kansas, at Barstool KU. We are the real basketball school." So it was only right for Barstool KU to come back with the heat this week after the win against the real basketball school. "Thanks for coming out, Baylor, at Barstool Sikkim. We are the real basketball school." And if you thought it ended there, KU continued Sunday morning. Retweet if you slept like this last night. Barstool KU then retook the crown as they released a video that brought silence to Barstool Sikkim. With the Big 12 tournament this week, we could potentially get another Twitter battle between the Barstool accounts. That's all I have for you this week. We will keep you updated on Twitter at PlaymakersKU for more tweets of the week. This week in the NFL, J.J. Watt made a big decision. Gabe Johnson and Caleb Jenneret are here with the total breakdown.
Former Texans defensive end J.J. Watt signed a 2-year, $31 million contract with the Arizona Cardinals. According to Ian Rappaport, Watt got a $12 million signing bonus with a base salary of $28 million. The sack and tackling specialist will get $3 million in his reports 10 or more sacks in his first season. He'll get a $1 million bonus, and his salary will increase another million in 2022. Each player has a cap hit, which is the amount of money an individual player takes up in the salary cap for his team. Watt's cap hit this season will be $9.5 million, and this season, and in 2022, it'll be $20.5 million if he hits his bonuses this season.
This new defensive line is nearly unstoppable with the addition of J.J. Watt. Starting off with Hassan Reddick, an outside linebacker with great pass rushing abilities as he registered 12.5 sacks last season. Next is young defensive end Zach Allen. In only his second year in the league, he recorded 2 sacks with 6.5 tackles for loss, and I even see a small amount of J.J. Watt's skill set in him. Then we get to J.J. Watt, 3-time Defensive Player of the Year and finalist for an MVP award, and his 95.5 sacks since 2012 are second to only one player, his brand new teammate Chandler Jones, who has 97 sacks since 2012. This defensive line was pretty dangerous already, but it just got even scarier.
There was a lot of speculation about where the 5-time Pro Bowler would land. The Bills and Packers were among top landing destinations for Watt. A lot of people were shocked he didn't pick Green Bay, as he was born and raised in Wisconsin. I do really like this signing with J.J. Watt and the Cardinals. I think it really solidifies that defensive line, makes them whole, and makes them a more balanced team now as they play in the tough NFC West.
Yeah, it's definitely unexpected, as I thought he was going to go to the Packers or the Bills, who really need that edge rusher, but he decided to go to the Cardinals, who already have solidified edge rushers, and he can just make that defensive line unstoppable almost.
Definitely. I feel like it really fills in the NFC West. You have Nick Bosa and the 49ers. You have Aaron Donald and the Rams, and now J.J. Watt. And the Cardinals, it's just a really defensive-heavy conference.
Yeah, if he can stay healthy, it's going to be a scary team.
For sure. J.J. Watt decided to keep his number 99, which was previously retired by the Cardinals. Marshall Goldberg wore that number for 5 seasons. Goldberg was a fullback for the Chicago Cardinals, but his career was interrupted during World War II. He spent 2 years with the Navy in Asia before returning to the Cardinals. Goldberg passed away in 2006 due to multiple concussions he sustained throughout his career. J.J. Watt spoke with his daughter Ellen about Marshall's memory. Ellen said he would have wanted J.J. to wear his number. He would want people to know his name and his story.
I can't wait to see the impact he has on and off the field in Arizona. Riley, how do you feel about J.J. Watt headed to Arizona?
Any team. But I'm really focused on where Russell Wilson could potentially land during the postseason, as the Chicago Bears have been hitting on the new addition. I know we have a few Bears fans as a part of the team and viewers, so we'll keep you updated after this short break.
Why doesn't my skin look like theirs? Why is my nose so big? I'm never gonna look like those girls.
We have some breaking news today for you, Jayhawks. The Baltimore Ravens have reportedly proposed the addition of an 8th official called the Sky Judge to aid the on-field officials during the games. Albert Breer of the MMQB tweeted a summary of what he was told the Sky Judge duties would be. The Booth Empire would then have access to all broadcast angles and replies. They would have open line to on-field officials, allowing them to correct any obvious on-field errors in real time. Hopefully this doesn't disrupt the game, because who wants to watch the refs instead of football?
Last week, the Jayhawks traveled to Lubbock for the Big 12 Conference, and the team did well as Alexandra Emelianov, Honor Finley, Samantha Van Hooke, Riley Anderson, and Zach Bradford qualified for the 2021 NCAA Indoor Track and Field Championship. The Jayhawks will travel to Fayetteville, Arkansas to compete in the championship from March 11th to the 14th. We're excited to see how our Jayhawks do and wish them the best of luck in the upcoming meet. Last week, Gus Bala began our recruitment special segment with Quay Davis. This week, Andrew Lind was at Sunrise Christian Academy as Grady Dick made his commitment. Andrew, you have more.
Thanks, Riley. I'm here at Sunrise Christian Academy, where just moments ago, 5-star basketball recruit Grady Dick from the class of 2022 committed to Kansas. Now, there was a lot of speculation about where he would land as he narrowed his schools down to 8, with several Big 12 conference foes in the mix.
With that being said, I'd like to announce that I will be committing to the University of Kansas.
I had the chance to talk with Grady about his commitment, and he said he was very grateful for the Kansas coaching staff and their constant communication throughout the recruiting process.
Actually, other schools, I kind of noticed that it's usually like one coach kind of contacting you and not really the whole staff, but with KU, it's just so special because it's literally the whole staff every day contacting me and kind of seeing a Hall of Fame coach like Coach Self having an interest in me.
Now, Dick will be joining his fellow teammate, Zachary Clements, who is committed to the class of 2021. Dick said Clements has been a big help in the recruiting process.
It's different when you have a commit and you know the inside of their basketball team from his perspective, and just kind of giving me advice about it every day is just really helpful.
I also had the chance to chat with head coach Luke Barnwell, who said Grady will be a nice addition to the Kansas Hoops program.
Yeah, I mean, I just think he fits well, like the way they've been playing, space and pace, less high-lows type stuff. And, you know, I think that's what's attractive for them, to find a guy that's 6'7 down the street that can shoot it at a high level.
That is all I have here from Wichita. Now back to the studio where my partner Zane Kanji and special guest Jacob Holacek break down what Grady Dick's commitment means to the Jayhawks.
Thank you, Andrew. As he said, I am here with Take A Side host and in-house recruit specialist Jacob Holacek. Welcome, Jacob. What can you tell us about Grady?
Well, thank you for having me. So Grady is a 5-star forward. He's 6'7". He can shoot the ball. He's got a high basketball IQ. This is a great addition for the Jayhawks.
Yeah, and with that size, he's going to be great for the KU system. But how do you think the chemistry between Grady and Zach Clements will carry on into the KU system?
Well, Grady and Zach are both great shooters, which will help the Jayhawks in a great way. It spaces the floor, and bringing in Kyle Cuff for that 2022 class, they've got a lot of talent coming in.
Yeah, what's one aspect of Grady's game that needs to improve before joining the Jayhawks in 2022?
Well, like I said, he can do a lot on the court, but I'd like to see him improve his playmaking abilities and really just improve his ability to get to the hoop.
And we saw Jayhawk Nation react all over the internet Wednesday night with Grady's announcement. What do you think? What was your favorite reaction that you heard or saw about Grady committing?
Oh, my favorite reaction had to be Zach Clemens picking up Grady in a video by Andrew Lind. It was just great to see how happy Zach was to see Grady joining the Jayhawks.
Yeah, it was. That was a special moment for both of those two. I would like to thank you for joining us today, Jacob. With this big announcement, the big hope for KU fans is to go on a three-peat, as they'll have Zach Clemens and KJ Adams next year, and then Grady Dick and Kyle Cuff Jr. joining the next. But we have reached our two-minute warning. Last week, Stephanie Morales-Mercedo was spot on with her prediction on Canelo Alvini fight this week. Madison Osberg-Lowe is doing the Winter X Games.
Welcome back to the two-minute warning. Next Wednesday, we'll kick off the start of the 2021 FIS Snowboard and Free Ski World Championships at the base of Buttermilk Mountain in Aspen, Colorado. The halfpipe, slopestyle, and big air competitions are scheduled on March 10th through the 16th, and then followed by another elite event, the Land Rover U.S. Grand Prix, March 18th through the 21st. Aspen Snowmass is no stranger to world-class competition. Buttermilk Mountain has been home to X Games Aspen for two decades, including an X Games in January that was successfully staged during the pandemic. For the World Championships, there will be no on-site spectators due to county health regulations on COVID-19, but all events will be streamed. The U.S. is sending 17 free skiers and 18 snowboarders to the World Championships, whose results will be seen as a preview of the 2022 Winter Olympics in Beijing, China. Snowboarder Chloe Kim, who placed first at X Games 1 month ago, is back in Aspen and ready to defend her World Championship title from 2019, when the events were held back in Park City, Utah. This is the first time in history the same nation is hosting back-to-back FIS World Championships, which are held every 2 years. In 1950, Aspen made its name on the international skiing map by being named as an FIS World Championship site. 71 years later, the championships return, but instead of skiers making turns around poles, athletes will perform spins and flips in a halfpipe with 22-foot walls through courses with rails and launch backwards and upside down off snowy jumps as high as a building. Stay tuned with me as I will be reporting live from Aspen, Colorado at the bottom of the halfpipe for 2 weeks of coverage. That's all I have for your two-minute warning. Back to you, Riley.
I hope you enjoyed today's show. Make sure to follow us on Twitter at PlaymakersKU to stay up to date with weekly live tweeting and highlights throughout the week. And next week, we will have a recap of Jayhawks NFL Pro Day with Puka Williams and Logan Kruseman. Lastly, remember, it's not about the game you played, but the plays you made. Rock chalk.